All right, thank you for coming out. I really appreciate you guys all coming out for this and have a lively discussion. I'm just gonna, can you guys hear me back there?
No.
Is that better? All right. No, profit isn't a dirty word. In fact, it's human nature to maximize profits over loss. If you're gonna reject profit seeking, you really have to reject all of human action. We're all constantly trying to maximize pleasure over pain in all the aspects of our lives. Trying to get the most out of our limited resources. It'd be silly to try to create something with scarce resources, making something that we didn't value. Marketplace just allows us to do that collectively in a far more effective manner and to coordinate and adjust our plans with other people. Most of you get excited when you go out and you get a good deal on a product, right? You're pretty excited. And why are you excited? It's because you're profiting. When you buy a good for more, you value it for more than the price you're paying, you're profiting. That's called consumer surplus. And that's present in every transaction you engage in because voluntary exchange is mutually beneficial. You wouldn't purchase a good unless you valued it for more than the money you're handing over. Yet somehow a consumer profiting when they take away resources from others, because when you purchase a good, you're denying other people the use of those resources. So when a consumer profits when they take away those resources from other people, somehow that's morally fine and no one criticizes that. But the producer, the person who used their mind, their time, and energy to create the good, when they ask to be compensated on that very same transaction, it's somehow morally reprehensible? Doesn't make sense to me. Profit seeking is just the philosophy of conservation, trying to meet as many needs as possible with as few resources as possible, freeing up resources to be used to produce other goods we value and for future generations. Part of that is that we shouldn't use scarce resources to produce things people don't want or value less than the other things that can be produced with those goods. A good example of that is chocolate-covered pickles. Pickles and chocolates are both things that people value in many different products. Yet when an entrepreneur combines them together, they actually destroy value because they could have been used to actually produce value in other goods. Yet when you combine them together, you're destroying value. We live in a world of scarcity. In other words, we have limited resources, but unlimited wants. And profit and loss system is the best system we know of to direct resources to their highest valued uses, away from chocolate-covered pickles and towards hamburgers and chocolate desserts. There's three major functions of prices. The first is that they transmit information. Second is they provide incentives to respond to that information. And third, those incentives determine the distribution of income by directing resources from those who misuse and mismanage those resources to where those who have been proven the best at utilizing those resources to create the most value for consumers. The pricing system offers, and I'm gonna go through each one of those. So I'm gonna start with the information. The pricing system offers an information aggregating, generating, and transmitting process able to call up and put to use widely dispersed information that no central planning agency, let alone any individual, can know, possess, or control. I've been on the ground doing field work in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and Joplin, Missouri, conducting interviews. And across all the interviews I conducted, I talked to charities, I talked to churches, I talked to government officials. They said, we would have been better off if people sent us money instead of donating goods. Think about that for a second. That's pretty profound. They're saying the generosity of the human spirit was not sufficient enough to meet the needs in Joplin, Tuscaloosa, those disaster-stricken communities. What they wanted is they wanted people to donate money to those communities. They could take that money, and then they could, because they relied more on the businesses, greedy businesses, responding to the profit and loss system to deliver the goods that were needed in those communities, more than they depended on those greedy businesses to effectively and efficiently get the goods that they needed in those communities, more than they could rely on the human cart. They actually called in-kind donations, donations of water, appliances, and clothes, the disaster after the disaster. They had to spend a whole bunch of time and resources managing those, and they actually sent most of them off to other communities because they didn't want to deal with them. The profit and loss system is able to direct businesses to get the right resources at the right time in the right amounts and the right quality. Now that it's time to rebuild in Joplin in Tuscaloosa, the price of electricians, plumbers, carpenters, and building supplies have shot up. Now you have to be careful. The profit and loss system did not make the prices go up in those communities. The tornado destroyed a wide section of the housing sectors in both of those communities. That's what made the prices rise. Now that the prices have risen, they do two things. They do one, they encourage conservation. So maybe you're here in Florida considering building an extension to your home. It's been several months since those tornadoes have stricken Joplin and Tuscaloosa, and you may have forgotten that they're just starting to rebuild right now. You may not even know there's a tornado in Joplin, Tuscaloosa, yet you go to price out that extension to your home, and suddenly the prices are higher. You say, you know what? I don't really need to build an extension to my house. So even if you don't know you're conserving resources to be used in Joplin and Tuscaloosa, consumers voluntarily say, you know what, my project isn't that important. And then the second function of the price rising is that we know that those resources are more urgently needed in Joplin and Tuscaloosa. It would take months, probably even years, to evaluate all the other construction projects going on in the country, somehow apolitically prioritize them, and then redirect those resources from those projects to Joplin and Tuscaloosa. The price system does it automatically. The information supplied by prices is necessary in order to ensure that resources are directed to their highest valued use, as dictated by consumers in a complex and constantly changing economy. There is no way any central planning agency could direct those resources with the efficiency that the price system can by aggregating and transmitting the knowledge of millions of consumers and producers. The second function of prices is they provide incentives. What good would it be to have some of the information to electricians and plumbers and carpenters and building supplies manufacturers that their resources were needed in Joplin and Tuscaloosa without providing the incentives? And a lot of people hear that and they say, you want to profit off of a disaster-stricken community? Well, my response, I have two responses to that. My first response is, really? You want to sit on your couch? What are you doing to help Joplin and Tuscaloosa rebuild? Sending them your dirty sneakers that they don't need or your clothes that they don't need? And you're going to sit on the couch and criticize the motives of the people that are doing the most to help Joplin and Tuscaloosa rebuild? We should criticize those people. They're doing more than anyone else to help those communities rebuild. The second response is that to the extent that we are greedy, short-sighted, irrational people, that's precisely why we need the profit and loss system, to harness our natural, greedy, and indolent proclivities in order to serve other people, including others that we may not know or even like. I suspect that most of you have no idea who made you the shirt that you're wearing right now. You don't know their sex, the sexual preference, the religion, the race, or anything about them. You may even hate that person if you ever met them in real life. Yet you bought it with no consideration because all you cared about was the value you got from that. The profit and loss system eliminates discrimination far better than any legislation or any law could do. The world would be a desolate place with very short life expectancies and terrible living conditions. In fact, life couldn't be sustained for the vast majority of us alive today if the world did not have people pursuing material well-being. Another way to look at this is Reader's Digest every couple of years does this study on honesty and politeness in cities around the world. They leave a wallet with money in it and see if it's returned. They see if people open doors for old ladies. Inveterately, New York City, the center of greedy capitalism, rates near the top in every single one of those as being one of the most honest and politest cities in the world. Another way to look at this is Dr. Heinrich conducting experiments using 15 tribal societies around the globe has found that those with the most contact with capitalism exhibited the least amount of greed and self-interest. All right, number three, the distribution of income. Now this is a tricky one. Everyone tries to avoid this one because they think that income incentives are good, but can I get a couple more minutes? All right. I'll give you a few more, sorry. I thought I'd go through this a lot quicker. This is a tricky one. Most people agree with the information incentives provided by prices, but they say, well, can we divorce it from the distribution of income? And I argue, no, that's impossible. If your income was the same whether you used your natural endowments, experiences, and talents to work hard or not, why would you work hard? If in your classes I took the top performing students, I took grade points from them, if gave them to the lowest performing students, how hard would you work in class? Just watch the transformation of American Idol contests as they compete against each other. It not only creates better musicians for all of us, it provides the incentives for people to push their talents to the limit, explore their full potential. The same thing happens in the marketplace. Every single dollar you spend in the marketplace is a vote. Not just like an American Idol, for the best car producer, the best software manufacturer, the best portable music machine manufacturer. You want the best singers getting the limited recording time, concert venues, and airtime, not the horrid pants on the floor singer. Just like you don't want a horrid portable music machine manufacturer taking away resources from Apple and Sony that have proven expertise in their manufacturing. You as consumers determine the distribution of income. And I'll wrap it up here. It's careful, I gotta be careful and say I'm arguing for the profit and loss system. Businesses that cannot survive without political favoritism in the form of subsidies, special tax breaks, and bailouts need to go under. Those resources need to be moved away from people manufacturing chocolate-covered pickles and the companies that are actually producing things people value. And finally, the profit and loss system has delivered. The genius of Adam Smith was that he recognized that the profit and loss system directed us out of our own self-interest to serve others. Those societies that have embraced economic freedom, allowing the profit and loss system to direct resources through the provision of incentives and information, to those that are the best at utilizing them to create values for consumers, they have higher standards of living, lower infant mortality rates, lower infectious disease rates, they live longer, the poor are best off in those countries, and most importantly, people are happier. Thank you.
Initially, you think you talk about condemning profit, the easiest route to take would be a religious route, because Christianity is notoriously hostile to profit. Judaism less so. Perhaps Islam is the only mainstream large religion of the West that, that condones business, perhaps because their prophet was a businessman. But we put that aside too. I'm going to go directly to the economics of profit. The funny thing is, I don't want to exploit the fact that I'm going second. So I'll just say one thing. I think that what we heard right now was a very eloquent argument for the effectiveness, even morality, of markets, and not really profit. No?
Move around. Ooh. Lovely. Try not to break out dancing. So I'll distinguish between profit and markets, and my focus is on profit, and even there, it's going to be a little complicated. I'll try. So what is profit? We've got a couple of problems here. First of all, I'd like to point out there's a question of degree. Right? I'm not advocating, or choose not to advocate, but some people may, having no profits. One could criticize profit as excessive, potentially. You see what I'm saying? It's not necessarily either fully non-recompensation for any effect, any success, versus excessive. We're looking for a balance point. There are also several kinds of profits. Now, maybe some of you have, how many of you have taken microeconomics? All right. Maybe you remember from Theory of the Firm, in your typical classic textbook, you have normal profit. Now, I'm not giving you a lecture, but you may recall that at the very least, it arises from competitive markets. That's a normal profit, as opposed to, in a second, excess profit, excessive profit. So we have here this more ideal situation, which that I think, you know, Daniel here was perfect at advocating, in which you have to compete about the quality of your good or the price of your good, and not with market power. Right, so this more honest kind of competition that indeed harkens back to Adam Smith's invisible hand. This is a good thing, according to most, certainly mainstream economists. It's allocatively efficient, which is a nice expression for invisible hand. Sadly, in the mature economies, certainly today in the United States also, that's a minority type of economic activity. The vast majority of economic activity in the United States is affected by monopolistic, or certainly not particularly competitive companies, right? In this case, we have excess profits, right? And that comes from monopoly power. You block the competition. You see, you sell shoddy goods, let's say, at an overpriced But the little guy who has a better product for cheaper has no way of competing with you. Several ways you may block them, and there's some important issues, which I'll get to in a second. This is probably, it is the majority of economic activity in the United States in mature capitalist systems. It's inefficient, and it's precisely the invisible hand not functioning. In fact, it's right out of Adam Smith. And my favorite quote from Adam Smith is, people of the same trade seldom meet together, even for merriment and diversion. But the conversation ends in a conspiracy against the public, or in some contrivance to raise prices. So Smith, back in the old days, the father of our modern discipline, was primarily concerned with all the many ways where the invisible hand does not work, not so much with how it is guaranteed to work. And that's important, I think. So where does this monopoly power come from? I have a couple of ways. What is the natural monopoly, it's called? It's probably the least problematic. It's when size matters. Yeah? In other words, when it's efficient to produce something really big. And there's no room for anybody else serving this market. Okay. Another element is we've experienced a tremendous amount of rising in the monopoly power through mergers and acquisitions, especially in the past couple of decades. And here you have a huge split, I have a paper on this, between jurisprudence, the rules about antitrust, about how much monopoly power is allowed. Most recently, there were a telecommunication merger that was blocked, for example. Versus 30 years of microeconomic theory conducted mostly in game theory that shows that there are many, many, many ways in which mergers and acquisitions causing giant companies is extremely problematic. It penalizes both the public, certainly, but also the investors, incidentally, who actually lose value, and rewards only a small group of insiders in the medium to long run. And that small group of insiders, underline that, please. Another way, in which we totally agree, we found out, is that you have this government that's dependent on monopolists' funding. Right, to get elected. We are very painfully aware of this now if we watch any television, or maybe somewhat entertained if you watch good television such as The Daily Show. So it's essentially cheaper to lobby, right, than to innovate or compete. So why innovate or compete? Those good Smithian market habits. Right? And a recent study, fascinating, the rate of return on lobbying right now in the United States is estimated at 22,000%. Spend $1 in lobbying, you get $220 back. Why bother doing anything else? Right? I don't think there's ever in history been such a rate of return for anything. So, and this is the problem with campaign finance reform. Such an extremely concentrated amount of wealth in the hands of the very few who have inordinate amount of influence and thus tend to use it to solidify their monopolies and undermine competitive markets, which again, we heard an excellent argument for why competitive markets are great. But we don't have so many of them left. And I really want to say that this is truly a nonpartisan and shocking. Everybody should kind of agree. A lot of people agree about that. Yet we don't seem to be able to solve the problem. That's disturbing. What's going on? Now, perhaps the most controversial element of monopoly. Perhaps the most controversial is the monopoly on owning capital. This is where I'm getting a little red here. In fact, I want you to note that until now, I consider what I did to be internal criticism. In other words, I accept markets, I accept the need for profits, but I challenge that we have counterproductive profits in action. Too much profits. The balance is out of whack. The way it's connected into the political system makes it too easy to undermine competition and create more monopoly power, and it's a vicious circle, right? Now I'm moving to an external criticism. I kind of reject outright the institution of profit. There is an outright cost to it, so it's more of a radical position. Let's go. That's what I'm here for. A market system of exchange. Right? That's one thing about capital, one characteristic, three characteristics of capitalism. I want to remind us that all markets have some degree of regulation. That's these laws of the game, you know, rules of the game, customs often. It's everywhere. Hunter-gatherer societies have forms of market. Even Soviet Russia had a lot of markets. You know? So market is pretty ubiquitous everywhere. Throughout history too, in different ways. Last two are the more problematic, ethically certainly kind. Private ownership of means of production. Means of production being capital, money, right? It's tools of production. Sometimes money is a tool of production, but a plumber's wrench is also capital. It's a good example of capital. So, I mean, note, it's the ownership of the factories, right? Of the shops, of the machines, the robots. That's the issue in question here. It's not some kind of generalized, it's bad to own stuff, private property bad. I'm sure there's some people out there who advocate that, but I think they're a minute minority, so I'll just disregard that, right? It's a particular property of means of production. And that leads consequently directly to the third kind, wage labor, right? Where the vast majority of us, actually the numbers roughly are, talking about Wall Street, 99% of Americans must work for a living. The other 1% don't have to, most of them do, but they can go home and live off the rent, the interest from what they already own. They have that option at the very least. Okay? Now, that's where profit comes from. Now, this imbalance, if you will, between a tiny minority of people who own the means of production and the others who are obliged to be employed by them. Or starve, basically. Right? And markets, as I said, are key institutes to everybody else. This is a very unbalanced, 99 to 1. I wonder if that's why they picked that particular, you know, ratio. And it creates this one called a monopsony. So it's a buyer's monopoly. The buyer of labor has all the power, and the seller of labor has very little. Because of the lack of options, lack of choice, lack of liberty. Right? There is no liberty for the 99%. In a large extent, is my argument here. All right? And I claim, let's talk after this, a little bit more for later, this is far from the classical ideal of a competitive market system as outlined by Smith and continued to be explored by many economists since. Let's stop here for a second.
All right, there's a lot of ground to cover here. Thank you. Okay, first I'm going to start out with excessive profit. The only way to measure excessive profit is subjective opinion. And when there's excessive profit, what does that mean? It means there's excessive maladjustment of resources. So that means there's a huge benefit for society whenever someone discovers that these resources are being misused or misallocated. So I think there should be a big reward for those people, that the once-in-a-lifetime people that come around, like Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, who find misallocation of resources, combine them in a new way, and create immense value for all of us. And we should reward that. I do agree with him completely on corporatism points. Government and businesses have been working together jointly. Lobbyists are a very corrupt society. But that's corporatism. Whenever you give government the power to interfere in the economy, of course businesses are going to buy for that power and compete against each other, donating money to buy out politicians. What you got to do is you cut off the ability of politicians to interfere in the marketplace, and then there's no way that corporations can have any power over anyone else. You dictate who gets money, which companies succeed, every time you vote or abstain from, every time you buy from a company or any time you abstain from buying from a company, you determine their profits. At the beginning of my class, I curve all the grades in my classes. So that means if all of my students get zeros throughout the entire semester, they all get A's, right? I agree to give them all A's. If they agree to all get zeros, they will all get all A's. Do you think it's ever happened? No. Why? Because you're competing. You're like, you're right. It's actually be more effective if I say C, because then they'll try to get better. They like cheat on it. They chisel. And that's what happens in the marketplace when businesses come together. People cheat on the agreement and work against. They end up, and that's what you see with OPEC. People are constantly cheating on the OPEC agreement. Businesses can't come together. They're too greedy to say, okay, I won't sell that many product. They find ways to chisel and cheat on that to make more money. So it's precisely the greed of businesses that prevents collusion from ever happening. As far as the power of corporations, I ask you, who has more power? The mechanic expecting your vehicle for the DMV, or the postal workers, or Apple or Google? How many of you, when you get the iTunes agreement, just click on it, I agree, 50 pages, you don't even read it? How much power do you think iTunes really or Apple really has over you? That's one of the major corporations, and you have no fear whatsoever. Yet you're sweating when you do your taxes. Corporations have zero power over you. Look at Gap, they tried to change their logo. Overnight, they had to change it back because too many customers complained. New Coca-Cola, they had to change it back because people complained. People said Microsoft was a monopoly. 5 years later, iPhone revenues are bigger than all of Microsoft revenues combined, just the iPhone revenues. The average life of individual Fortune 500 companies is only 30 years. In fact, there are only 71 of the original 1955 Fortune 500 companies still on the list today. And almost 50% of the companies on the list were replaced just from 1999 to 2009. The same things happen in income mobility. We're talking about the 1% like they're some constant group. No, the people in the 1% are constantly changing. If you take a look at mobility studies of people over their lifetime, in a 15, 20-year period, the vast majority of the people in the lowest classes are moving up into even the highest classes. So it's a constant income mobility. And you can't just look at 99% versus 1%. You actually got to look at the ability of the average American in the lower classes to rise up. And when you look at that data, it's clear we have opportunity in America. The profit and loss system is working for poorest people and allowing them to rise to the top.
Okay. In response, first of all, corporatism, that we both agree is a significant, if not the significant, disease in America, does exist. You know, so if we could stop it, if we reform the electoral way the electorate work, as well as the influence of lobbying and all those things, corporatism, then we could deal. These things would happen: this upward mobility, the innovation, more competition, all those wonderful things would then be unleashed. So, yet I have to insist that it's here, it's dominant, and it's not going away. Hopefully, yes, but not so far. So that's one point of rebuttal that I have. Another one, that's a big one because I worked like 3 years on this. Collusion does happen. That bad mouthing of profit or at least the schemes of profit by Smith, businesses do get together to raise prices, fix prices. OPEC broke down eventually, indeed, but we are surrounded. I claim, and you know, maybe we'll probably continue by email to argue about this. You know, I'll send you my paper and you'll tear it apart and be fun. So it's possible. In fact, that's what I meant when I said 30 years of micro theory and game theory show that there are numerous, numerous ways. Maybe in the question and answer, ask me, hey, tell us a couple of interesting ones, and I'll be happy to. How this is achieved, where companies limit competition, cooperate amongst each other against the consumer, thus violating in the hands of allocated efficiency, etc., etc. Another kind of factual argument that we have is affordability. My answer is no, it's not. In fact, statistically, your chances, if you split income into, like, let's say, quintiles, right, into five, from the poorest 20% to the richest 20%, your chances of dying at the higher quintile than your parents was at the good old days of American capitalism, i.e. 60s, you know, after the war until mid-70s, was in the teens, low teens, and in fact it's significantly lagging in America today behind other rich countries who themselves are very much lagging also. So it's pretty abysmal. Recently developments are even more worrying that a lot of people are falling down in the income and wealth distribution. So they start off in middle class and end up poor in their lives. So here we have, of course, a congestion of facts, but facts are problematic and depend on interpretation, etc. Let me try and go through a quick list of ethical justification of profit, some of which were raised. And I'll skip them because we have little time here. We'll just deal with some of them. We talk a lot of this entrepreneurial creativity. And, you know, it's hard to argue against entrepreneurial creativity. But once again, I'd like to point out the engineers, the workers, people who are not owners of capital, who are not getting profit due, and this is what profit is, due to
happening to own tools, being often born rich if you buy into my statistics. Gives you opportunity to earn profit, while a lot of the entrepreneurial creativity and innovation is done by other people. So I'm strictly saying that this entrepreneurship is not dependent on profit. It maybe comes from other things, not from profit necessarily at least, right? Now, you have compensation for risk, right? Again, an entrepreneur takes risk. Without them, we're in this kind of mire of nobody daring to move anywhere. Well, I'd like to be a little facetious here. I wrote, like the banksters who destroyed the global economy, right? They took the risk, we paid it, didn't we? In fact, some of us like to joke about that and say that after the bailout, we basically have a system which is socialism for bankers and law of the jungle for the rest of us. So that doesn't seem to fit the model too. So, finally, consider the monstrous rate of profit that we're measuring today among these giant monopolies, and certainly the very banks that took the bailout, making profits like nobody's ever in recorded history made before. Right? All this profit, yet little job creation, hardly any investment. Where's that money going? That's where it's supposed to go, under those ideal or closer to ideal condition of a true competitive market. What creates job is demand, right? Where the firm thinks, the company thinks that people are going to buy its stuff. You're going to hire people to make more of it. You'll invest in more machinery and better technology, etc., and you will lead to growth. So profits are not the source of all these wonderful things and potentially have some detrimental effects. Those people have access to nothing. And shockingly, sadly, and wrongly, there's quite the deepest in the rich world, poverty in America. So there's certainly a segment of the population that is low, where no other rich country in the world allows any of its people, not even its beggars, to reach. So I want to give them an attention. However, among those who have some opportunity to invest in something or to have their Social Security or their retirement funds invested in the stock market or what have you, it's a tiny, including myself, it's a tiny proportion. And here's that focus I kept, and thank you for allowing me to stress why I was adamant about it. My concern in this talk was about those who own the means of production in a meaningful, some kind of level of control. And then you're talking about a much more concentrated group of people. So the fact that some of us own a little chunk, we don't have voting rights for this. It doesn't really significantly affect our behavior. It's certainly not there that the problem lies.
Can I respond to that if no one else is questioning?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. I just say that around the world, where you see that kind of poverty that he's talking about, it's in precisely those areas that reject the profit and loss system, reject economic freedom. Now, and I disagree about the poor in America. If I was going to be poor in any country around the world, you could set a list. It's going to be all the Western nations that have developed economic freedom, the profit and loss system. The poor in America, you look at the statistics, 70% of them have air conditioning. Most of them own cars. Most of them have TVs. Most of them have DVD players. The poor in America are better off than the vast majority of the world and the vast majority of all people throughout all of human history. And if I was going to be poor at any time in history or any place in history or in the world, it would be in America at this time.
Quite relevant. Now in the budget, in Obama's budget actually, there's some discussion about that, so totally the news from the last few days. One of the things is that the corporate tax rate actually in America is not particularly low. In fact, if you measure it ideally, it's relatively high for rich countries, right? Problem is that the loopholes bump it down to an effective rate that is at the very bottom of all industrial countries.
And again, I mean, my issue about comparing the poor in America was compared only to rich countries, of course. Naturally. Otherwise, but compared to other capitalist countries, it's much deeper. So would they, when they are monopolies, as indeed they increasingly are, yes, they would. They have the opportunity to pass along price increases because you don't have the competitive pressure. So again, the problem of the ideal capitalism versus the one in which we live. And perhaps we both agree that we'd like to push it towards that direction. We have some other fundamental philosophical differences. I hope you see that we're quite friendly despite having vehement disagreement. That's what might be more interesting, isn't it? It's boring to hang out with people that agree with you all the time.
Might if I jump in?
Yes.
All right. I'd say that corporate taxes are some of the most aggressive forms of taxation that we have. Look at the top corporations in the U.S. They serve regular people, including poor income people. Many of you have probably seen the Faces of Walmart website that makes fun of socially undesirable people that shop at Walmart. People look at that and laugh. I actually look at that and say, I am thankful Walmart is out there serving these socially undesirable people that the rest of us just sit there and laugh at. Walmart is out there serving them directly. And when you put on taxes, it's going to hurt corporate taxes, it's going to be passed on to consumers. It's going to hurt the poorest the worst, because when they go out and buy bread, it's a larger percentage of their total budget than when a rich person goes out and buys bread. And then I'd also add out to that, income, when a rich person earns income, it's taxed at 36%. Then when they invest it in a company, the corporate tax is 35%. So that they earn the income, 36%, they invest it in a company, 35% is taken away. And then when they receive that income from the corporation, it's taxed at 15%. And then when that person dies, 50% of it is taken. Where in there are we not taxing them enough?
The loopholes. Nobody pays 35%. In fact, recently we know that some of the biggest corporations pay zero. And then there's income, which again, in the news today, right? I like to tie things into current events, right? Everybody made a big hoopla in the Republican primaries about Romney paying an effective tax of 15% despite being a multi-billionaire, while middle-class people pay typically 20. Again, interesting, no? We're learning something here. The ideal versus the de facto, often through government and other tricks, which I mentioned, that I heard of.
So, this is all hypothetically speaking. If I was to make a car that ran on air, groundbreaking, yes? Can I charge 100 times what the production cost was? Yet people were clamoring to buy it. Is that wrong with me, or should I be able to do it?
Well, that leads me to this one. Okay. First of all, personally, again, I'm not representing, who am I representing exactly?
Can you restate the question for us, because we're not hearing that mic
too. Okay. So I'll restate it. Extremely innovative good.
Yes.
Would it be ethical to get a massive profit rate off of that good? Basically, right? Okay. So, a couple of things. Who made that monster innovation? So, for example, there is an element where it might, where does that massive profit that we're evaluating here ethically go to? Does it go to the engineer, the company that invested all the research in technology, or may it go evaporate into some IPO that only a few funds are invited to join, such as Facebook pretty soon? Usually you're not invited to buy into it.
Let's just say it's a privately owned company.
A rarity,
Chick-fil-A.
A rarity, first of all, that they're privately owned. True. I think that it is an excellent example where massive returns for an extremely innovative technology is really not a problem, ethically, because of what it, the amazing benefit that it generates. However, having said that, since you're talking technology here, it allows me to add Microsoft. right? This has actually come, it has been articulated by Bill Gates Sr. recently, who advocated for being taxed more. You know, he's one like Warren Buffett, only, I don't know, I think he's more interesting, especially because this is the guy who really created wonderful products, technological products. And of course, think of all the technology, all that internet stuff, right? Important stuff. Let's not forget where it came from. Who developed the internet? Public fund, your tax money working, all entirely. Military, who developed the basics, physics, electronics, who even began to work on this sort of thing back in the 40s. Public universities, funded by National Science Foundation. Right? Who built the highways on which my Amazon boxes come to my house on a regular basis? You see, Amazon, one of my favorite, Google Amazon, favorite. So, what Bill Gates Sr. says is, I am an entrepreneur, I'm successful, so is my son, we deserve to be filthy rich, and I agree. I agree with him because he is willing to give back something, at least recognizing that he used infrastructure that was bought by the 300 million Americans, and without it, couldn't have done it. So there's at least a necessity for fairness, you need some degree of sharing. Exactly how is tricky.
So it's not 15% of $1 trillion, the same thing as 15% of $37,000?
What?
Of your income, yeah.
Only good that. No, but the rates are different. And there, it's worth, yeah, I mean, you know, Romney's got billions, to use this example that everybody was all on and on about, because not so much, but somebody doesn't even have to, a lot of activities are simply not taxed, or they are mass amounts of loopholes. In fact, in this way, I'll get to the right wing, I would like to see the tax system radically simplified, frankly. In fact, I'm in many cases with very famous right wingers like Friedman and others, and a whole bunch, the current system makes it a joke because of the endless loopholes. Companies also now, you've heard all these accountant frauds. I mean, you can move profit off to offshore accounts and end up paying, really, the big corporation in America pay zero, not 15% like wrong, zero. Look it up. While the general population pays larger percentages of smaller, significantly smaller amounts. But we should focus on these loopholes that if you are powerful enough, you can get away with. And perhaps it's corporatism too. I mean, I think it is actually that you allow it. In fact, right now what's going on, negotiating between Obama and corporate America, who rules, doesn't matter if it's Democrat or Republican, precisely they say, well, okay, we're willing to pay a higher corporate tax rate because it'll make us look good, and you too, Mr. President. So long as you keep the loopholes in place. And that's currently an argument. Because they're saying, okay, I'll pay 20% to them, because anyway, I end up at zero. I'll pay 30. No. It's generous. Because I know I have the loopholes to get rid of it all. So again, the ideal versus the actual what's going on is very important. Too often we get just pushed to the ideological ideals, and I really think it's almost like a conspiracy. In the back, somebody's going like, doesn't matter what you guys argue about, I'm getting my way.
I would argue that I completely agree with him on the loopholes. I said in my talk, I'm against giving special privileges to any businesses that need to compete on equal margins. So we both agree with that. But I want to focus, there's a lot on there I wanted to focus on, but I'm going to focus exclusively on the excessive profits. When cell phones came out, they're about $2,000, $3,000. They're these huge things. They barely worked. They weren't, like, no one knew really, there weren't that many cell phone engineers at that time. There weren't many cell phone towers, but they made a lot of profit off of very rich people. The very rich people buying those first products, first cell phones, defrayed the cost of investment into those technologies. And less than 15 years later, people had them in their hands for like 40, 50. You could buy a cell phone for 10 bucks from certain companies right now. If we had cut off those excessive profits, if we said as soon as the cell phone came out that you can't make those profits off of them, do you think all these engineers would have gone into the cell phone making business? Do you think people would have invested into cell phone towers to make it readily available for all of us? The luxuries of today quickly become the necessities of, or luxuries of tomorrow, or yesterday, quickly become the necessities of today. That's happened throughout all of human history. At some point throughout human history, there's people standing outside, peasants standing outside a rich person's home and saying, I hear he uses a fork to eat. What godless, self-indulgent luxury. But quickly, because people invested in that technology, they quickly invested in making those things, like knee replacement surgeries. Only the rich used to be able to afford those. Doctors moved into that field, we got technology, people move in because of the high profits in those fields. They move into that field, they develop technology to make it more readily affordable for people, and now it's a commonplace surgery. So if we curb those profits, that type of technology getting out to the people that the common people would not occur.
U.S. handles their profits. Is there anything that makes the U.S. unique to similar countries in the way they handle their profits?
I'm trying to understand your question. I don't.
Well, I, you just keep. We're only talking about Americans, but we're still talking about profit.
Mm-hmm.
Do all countries similar to the U.S. with economies like ours, do they all handle profit the same way?
Well, when you look across the evidence, there's a couple economic freedom rankings, Index of Economic Freedom. I forget what the other names are off the top of my head right now, but there's actually three of them. And they correlate income and economic freedom. And across all of them, a very, very strong, robust relationship between economic freedom and income. So the countries that embrace economic freedom, that allow entrepreneurs that create things to keep that, to earn profits, because they're the best at it, right? There's only a few people in the world that are good at being an NFL quarterback, right? There's only a few people in the world with world-class talent to do that. Same thing with the entrepreneurs. There's only a few people in the world like that that can spend money so effectively to create so much value for us. If you took away all Bill Gates' money and gave it to me to spend, or worse, all the politicians in D.C., we would spend it way worse at creating value than those entrepreneurs. We should allocate, we should push all those resources to those who are the best at making them and utilizing them to serve all of us. Does that answer your question? Or?
Pretty much.
Oh, God.
So if you do believe that profit is a bad slash dirty word, are you suggesting that we move to a more socialistic society, which most have not succeeded?
Well, again, you know, remember, I'm saying that profit should be, is not perfect. Indeed, you know, a little bit segue to the answer right now. We haven't, our infrastructure in America is in a shoddy state. Our average internet speeds are way below other rich countries. Our cell phone system is what Europeans or Japanese or South Koreans had 15 years ago. I'm a big geek, so it hurts me every day, you know, to realize I only have 40 megabytes, you know, all my friends for half the price get 100 connections. So it's all very nice to allow Bill Gates, and I don't have an essential problem with much reward to signal, right, believe the same, to attract to a productive area, but balance again. Now, if we lose our infrastructure, then we will all collapse together. And Bill Gates' daddy, at least, clearly agrees with it. I'm quite sure what Junior has to say about it, agrees with this problem. So, again, if we have enough to pay exuberant returns to those entrepreneurs, which I think there are many more. I like the engineers too, and not just the entrepreneurs. I'll admit that I'm a little bit skeptic about that. The stars. I think the stars depend on a lot of teams beneath them that do not have purchase on that on those excessive profits. They get salaries, good ones, I hope, but still nothing like it. So it's a matter of balance, essentially, and if we neglect the whole other element while we do it, like our healthcare, which just recently we're ranking 49 in the world in life expectancy, life expectancy, you can measure it in several ways, I'm not sure, I mean, email will give you the exact reference, but you know, we're sacrificing other things, so I advocate balance. I'm not advocating on a nightmare socialist world in which we take all of your profit. If you excel, you don't get any better than those who failed. In fact, that's what our financial industry, which still rules the country and the world, Then none of them went to jail. None of the books of the banks have been opened to see what the assets and liabilities look like. They just completely screwed up and went home and gave themselves a few hundred million dollars extra bonus for it. So they should, markets cannot come in and correct for that. All right, so that's excessive. Those bonuses, if you will, are excessive profits. You fail. Yet for you, it is Stalinistic socialism if you work for Goldman Sachs. But for those millions of people that have lost their jobs, lost their houses, too bad for you. So it's a matter of balance, not about going too far. And finally, everybody's hybrid today. Functioning better, not as well, but there are elements of social democracy in the most capitalistic of places. In fact, you'd be amazed to find a lot of principles of socialism being acted out in the way technology is produced in the United States. For example, take Google. You don't think of that as a socialist company, right? But pay scales are very egalitarian, relatively. Workers, sure, these are knowledge workers, right? Have a lot of control over how they work. You probably heard about how they can go and play basketball for a week, not write a line of code, because the company trusts them to, at the end of the month, produce something amazing. It's up to them if they want to work in the middle of the night and play basketball all day. That's acceptable. Something in a hierarchical corporate structure is unacceptable. So I kind of want to problematize. It's a very interesting field that some people are working in, and how these kind of egalitarian approaches work well in high-tech industry, which is clearly where we still have some comparative advantage and might revive again, despite the damage done when the dot-com bubble exploded and the brilliant future in technology that America seemed to see at the end of the 90s turned into a financial bubble that, you know, smoked up 20 years of growth. And we don't even know how bad the trouble is because we've never opened the damn books. In 82, when there was a similar but much smaller scandal with savings and loans, Ronald Reagan, not exactly a socialist, nationalized all the savings and loans, wasn't afraid of that word, opened them all up, got his accountants to see, okay, what did you got? What did you fraud? You fraud, jail, you know? And what are the assets? This is worth nothing. Sorry, you know? This has some residual value. We haven't done any of that, which is a crime. Literally a crime. So Ronald Reagan, you know? Be pragmatic. Again, let's go away from the ideology. In some ways, you know, the bailout was a kind of a socialism for the ultra-rich who speak against socialism the loudest. And in some ways, you have leaders like, you know, the late Ronald Reagan, certainly not ideologically a man of the right, who did the socialist thing because it made sense in that particular condition. But of course he privatized them afterwards. But this time around, the notion of we must nationalize them so experts can, federal commission, the trade commission, could look in there and see what we got, and see what happened, what's going on. It was taboo. Us can't nationalize. In fact, some countries like Germany are doing better because they did. Because they did and settled the problem.
My turn. When you look out and look at what products you consume or services you consume that you're least satisfied with, most people answer the post office system and public education system. What's true about both of those? Government provision. Government provides both of those, and those are some of the worst provided services we have. If we want, we need updates in infrastructure. The best way to get it is allow private companies in the profit and loss system operating under that, dictated, they're following your consumers, what you prefer, they're gonna provide the infrastructure that you need. As far as the internet right now, there's the two top things that are looked at on the internet are video game cheat codes and adult content. Why do we need to expand public access to that? The private companies are already doing that. They do have local monopolies, and I'd fight against that and say we need to get rid of those. But I want to move on to the bigger point is we're saying that we both agree that business owners in the marketplace, they're greedy, they're indolent, they're lazy, they're exploiting, they're corrupt, But in the profit and loss system, they're directed to serve you. That's the only way they can make money, is by serving you, providing you with something that you value more than the money you're handing over. Now, if we're going to assume people are greedy, indolent, and lazy, and corrupt, well, you also have to assume that in the public sector, politicians are greedy, corrupt, indolent, and lazy, right? So when you assume politicians are like that, that actually gives you the explanation for why the financial crisis occurred. If I said, go to Vegas, all your losses I will cover, but any profits you make, you get to keep. How risky are you going to be when you gamble? You're going to be extremely risky, right? You can't lose any money. You can just make money. That's exactly what politicians did by saying, we're going to bail you out because you're too big to fail. We promise we're going to bail you out. Fannie and Freddie Mae, both government-sponsored enterprises. They dealt with 70% of the failed loans here at that time were sponsored by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. They were created explicitly to give loans to people that could otherwise not afford them. So you got to look at the problem is actually the politicians giving out all these special privileges and favors to corporations. So the solution can't be give more power to politicians if they're the source of the problem, right? You got to give power back to the consumers and allow you to dictate which corporations earn money and which ones don't.
Private companies should and can provide the best services, as was just mentioned. But in some, they can't. So for example, a private company would have never built the internet. Nobody can take such a risk for such a humongous. It had to be the US military to kickstart it, and a hell of all the subsidies over a really long time to make it happen. It's a special case. High-speed trains in France and Germany and more and more places. 15 years of losses covered by government. Much scandal, by the way. Even back then, I was a little bit more skeptical and was screaming myself too over there. After 15 years, that amazing infrastructure zooming around at 300 miles per hour is beginning to generate very good profit, has been privatized, and ends up returning good returns to its initial investors. So some projects are so big, the profit is so far away, the costs are right now, that private can do it in the right mind without some kind of guarantee. Now, another similar situation where you just have to be specific to the problem and kind of get beyond the ideology is precisely that Vegas example. It's a wonderful example, yeah, moral hazard we call it, right? And indeed, of course, we've seen the banksters, and I love that FDR expression, I think it's so apt. It was apt then, it's even more apt now. The banksters have gotten that deal, and they got it through government. But it's not that government invariably one day decided to allow them to get away with murder. They lobbied very effectively over many years, harnessing think tanks, ideologies, feelings, and many ways to get through mass deregulation, dumb deregulation. Sometimes it's good with deregulation. Under Clinton, by the way, that's mostly, don't forget. So Democrat, Republican, I can barely tell the difference, two country clubs on two sides of the road. It depends.
Daniel, do you
want to
respond to that one, and then we'll just have one more question.
All right, yeah, as far as, I won't respond to what you said, I'll just respond to your question. As far as, I agree with him, I'd say Milton Friedman once said that if you can find something in the yellow pages, in the business section, the government shouldn't do it. We should privatize everything that can be done by a private company. And I'd take that to the extreme, something like police services. Like, think about Disney World, the police at Disney World. Have you ever heard anyone accuse a police officer at Disney World, who's a private employee of that company, not a public police officer? Have you ever heard about racial profiling by police working for Disney World? Have you ever heard about cops excessively speeding by police at Disney World? Why not? Because they would lose profits if those police abused their power. Yet you see that frequently when you have public police. So I would say we could do it a lot. We need creative thinking to think of ways we can push free market provision that will improve the public's, what the public sector has been traditionally providing. And as far as, I will respond a bit, as far as financial deregulation, if you actually look at the amount of money spent by regulatory agencies on the financial sector as well as the Federal Registry, there was no financial deregulation. It's more in rhetoric rather than practice if you look at the growth of the areas.
Okay, one more question.
They're safe. Well, they're instruments they use. I mean, people like, okay, let's say I own a company, and like an airline company, and I want to equalize, here's oranges. We'll use an oranges example. So let's say we know there's a bad crop, we know bad weather is going to come in and destroy oranges. It's going to be a terrible crop. So what do we know what's going to happen to those orange prices in the future? They're going to go up, right? Because there won't be as many oranges in the future as we expected there to be. So what should you do now? You should consume less oranges now in order to save more for the future, right? So if there's going to be a shortage in the future, the price of oranges rises today, you start conserving, and there's more oranges available for tomorrow. So that's all the financial markets do, is that they actually smooth out consumption. We know there's going to be a shortage of oil in the future. We should start conserving oil now. Allow the prices to rise now so we equalize and smooth out that consumption. If we don't, that means we're going to have a big shortage of oil in the future. We're consuming it excessively right now. So you've got to allow financial markets to equalize and smooth out consumption. Does that make sense?
It makes sense to me, but once again, I have to say one more thing, is that you can have insurance, you can have derivatives, it's simply, you can bet on anything you want. Problem is, one, if you lose, who pays? When you go to Vegas and, you put money on the table and you lose, right? You took the risk and you lost it. So once again, it's the specifics a little bit. What happened was a system that